Welcome to another inspiring message with Pastor Deborah Bell from Deo Gloria, South Africa, as she brings you a word from God.
Professor, and I mean that's what she studied for 20 years is the brain. And they've now proved, and I said this to you previously, that there are different little branches, and you know, if some of you have studied psychology and biology and all the other stuff, you'll know what those little things are, those neurons and the branches and everything else. And you've got this one tree in an unhealthy mind that speaks negatively or that has negativity, constantly looks like a Halloween tree. Actually looks like that. The picture in the brain physically will look like that. But a person that has positive thoughts, and I'm not talking about just positive thinking, I'm talking about the person that's trained and wrapped in godliness, this positiveness going into their spirit being, their branches, that tree looks full of life in the brain. And there's a very, very strong connection between how we think and the way we think as to our physical health and also our spiritual health. Mm-hmm. And so all of that impacts. So I really want you, that book is amazing. And I want to encourage you to get hold of it if you can. So we must train ourselves in godliness. It's no good just making our bodies look good or making people think we're good and we're okay, but on the inside, we're actually spiritually dying. The other side of that coin is that it's not always what we want people to think, but actually that we don't realize how important our spiritual well-being is. It's just as important, if not more important, than your body. It's no good me praying for somebody's healing on their leg, let's say, okay, if their spirit is going to help. You know, your body's going to die when you die, when that time is up, it's up. And so what are you going to do then? You don't take your body with you. So your spirit needs to be well. Train yourself toward godliness, keeping yourself spiritually fit. Some of us spend hours and hours on our bodies looking good, but no, nothing. We're not prepared to sacrifice. We're not prepared to spend time in prayer. Because you know, it's not all about us then. And yet it is about us, but we don't even see that building a relationship with Jesus Christ is the most healthy thing you can do for your being, because you were created to worship Jesus. You were created to bow your knee. You were created to serve the Lord. We spoke about godliness accompanied by contentment is great gain. We said that's not inherent holiness. It is really just saying, Lord, I'm making you a principal part of my life. It's saying I'm not going to rationalize my conscience. I'm not going to allow my mind to find reasons to excuse what my spirit knows is wrong. It's called rationalizing. That's what we do. We rationalize. Justify. Paul said in Philippians, I've learned to be content, whatever the circumstances, because I know what it is to be at need, and I also know what it is to be in plenty. But I've learned the secret, he says, of being content in every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, living in plenty or want, because I can do all things through Christ, who strengthens me. And I think sometimes we become disillusioned Christians and we get off the racetrack, because this sermon is called A New Direction for those that weren't here last week. And we get off the racetrack of spiritual discipline when we get disillusioned about life. Instead of having 5 hills to go over on the track, the trainer says, listen, you've got 10 to go over. And we're going, but I thought there were 5. And now you've got to jump 10. So what do? You rebel. I'm not jumping 10. Are you with me? I'm jumping 5. We said 5 and it's 5. Well, the trainer just pushes you that little extra mile. Why? What do you normally do? Your body and your mind and everything just goes into rebellious mode. I don't want it. Why is the trainer doing that? Because the trainer knows your potential. The trainer can see the awesome plan that God has for you. And unless you change to go the extra mile, you're never ever going to know that you can even do it yourself. Amen. But you can. tonight, as we bring this to, I don't think I should say as we bring this to a close, but I'll say it anyway out of the door. Okay, so the first point is to live out your life in the new direction you have. You have to rely on faith, not feelings. To live your life out in the new direction you have to rely on faith, not feelings. And I said to you last week, I quoted that scripture in 1 Timothy, and it says, Timothy, my son, I give you this instruction. In keeping with the prophecies once made about you, we think Paul wrote this, obviously. Everybody thinks it's Paul. Some people say it might not be, but let's say it's Paul. I give you this instruction in keeping with the prophecies once made about you, so that by following them, you may fight the good fight. Last week I said to you that the problem with us is that when we move out of the new direction that we have when we're in Christ, the direction we're moving to, the promised land, when we move out of that direction, we actually forget about all the prophecies over our lives. We forget about all the promises God has for us, because immediately we move back to the old. And that's the worst thing we can do, because those are the very things that sustain our vision for growth. You know, when you are believing and you have central in your mind the focus of where you're going, it's much easier to get to your goal when you know where you're going. When you know who you are meant to be, who you're called to be in Christ, and you know the end result, in most cases, you know your kingdom purpose, it's much easier to get to where you need to be.
Amen.
So here he is talking to Timothy, and he's saying, listen, you must keep with the prophecies made about you, so that by following them you may fight the good fight, holding on to faith and good conscience. And then he says, some have forsaken or rejected these two things, and so they should break their faith.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I said to you last week, that when we are not moving in the new direction that God has called us to move, we can shipwreck our faith.
Mm-hmm.
We shipwreck everything we believe in. It just gets broken and battered on the rocks. And you know what? We're so oblivious, because when we're moving in the opposite direction, we don't even realize how much we've taken over again.
Mm-hmm.
Until the ship hits the rock. And so when we go in the right direction, we prosper. When we reject our faith and we leave a good conscience behind, we move off God's plan and God's intention, and we should break our faith. So I started off with this point to say that we have to rely on faith, not feelings, as we live out our new life in this new direction. Why? Because your feelings are unreliable. I mean, one day you can wake up feeling this way, the next day you can wake up feeling completely something else. Feelings are completely unreliable. People are going to tell you this, and people are going to tell you that, and all sorts of funny things. And you know, if you rely on your feelings, you're going to be in trouble, because then you're going to listen to the wrong things. And when you take a new direction, the whole thing is that you don't rely on what you feel, you rely on the Word of God, because that's what builds your faith. Faith comes by hearing and hearing the Word. And we lose our faith when we stop that, when we cut ourselves off from our faith. And so when you take this new direction, it can be very confusing for you if you're listening to the wrong voices. Your feelings can blow this way, and then your feelings can blow that way. See, I want to tell you something. Faith honors God, and the result of that is that you will go and get to where God has promised you.
Amen.
And you can't live in faith if you're living on feelings.
Yeah.
You're either living by your feelings or you're living on faith.
You've been watching Pastor Deborah Bell from Deo Gloria, South Africa.
Passion for